We're ready to take questions. Maybe we can ask all speakers to join in. I think Dr. Dhruv had a question. He wants to know what is non-data ink, which you talked about.
Colors. So some people have got a tendency to color their figures and beautify them. So that's not required in scientific publication. You really don't need to do that.
Good evening, this is Dr. Abhishek. I have one question that at times I come to a situation where 90% of my data has been enclosed in Word table.
What has been what into a table?
90% of the data which I have to write, that results, yeah. I mean, that results, they are already included.
आपके पीछे आवाज बहुत है. There is lot of noise behind you. Can't really understand what you are trying to say.
Meanwhile, somebody.
Fair enough. What I understand is probably you are saying that if you find that 90% of your results are already included in one of your tables, what should you do? You don't have any material to write in the text. Well, if you can do that, and if you have 90% of your data into your text,
yeah, hello.
Awesome. I don't think there can be anything better than that.
Hello.
And is there any unsaid or said rule that like how much that discussion should contribute to an one of the reviewers said that it should not be more than 25% of the rest of the methods introduction and results.
So a rough rule of thumb to tell you, most of the original articles would be about 3,000 words. A good introduction can definitely be completed in 500 to 600 to 700 words. A good method section, again, can be done within 500 to 600 words. A discussion usually is about 800 to 1,000 words. And the results could results are written in another 500, 600 words. And your conclusion in about 100 to 200 words. Dr. Ravindran might want to take it up because he's editing so many, but that's just a rule of thumb that I would like to share.
Thank you, Dr. Goyal. Dr. Ravindran, would you like to add to it? I can unmute you. Right.
I think what Dr. Goyal said is correct. I mean, I think, you know, what I would like to highlight is that whatever you want to say, if you have said it, don't look at the number of the words, you know. Some very good piece of research do not extend beyond 1,500 words in total. So, for a review and all that, you will have a brief that, you know, it has to be 1,500 or 3,000 words. For the original articles, the word limits are actually unset. Okay, you may have a lower limit of the word count, like for, because then of course the journals like ours want to categorize them in brief report as opposed to the original articles. In terms of the value, the recognition, everything is safe, but it is just the lower number of word counts. You know, we put them as a brief report. And of course, you know, if it's a pilot study and if it is a preliminary results and things like that. For the introduction and the discussion, what Dr. Goyal said is correct. You know, see if your total, let's say brief is 3,000 words, then easily sort of, you know, 500 odd words for the introduction and double of that, about 1,000 words for the discussion. But in the introduction and in the discussion, you want to convey something very, very specific. And also in the results and methods, you want to make a very clear and often detailed statement of what was done and what has been found. So if you can achieve that in 1,000 words, 1,500 words, fair enough. If you need more than that, then of course, you know, within the brief given by the journal in terms of instructions to the authors, and then it should be fine. Okay.
I had this question for Dr. Durga. Now, he did mention about approval, I mean consent. Now, if we have case patients whom we have followed up, and this is a retrospective case series, and we have lost the patient to a follow-up, can we get an ethics committee clearance for informed consent not being taken?
Yes, thank you for this question. Yes, indeed, if it's a retrospective review of records, wherein you are not going to get directly in contact with the patient, the Indian regulations are very clear. They allow the ethics committee to give you a waiver of consent. But still, you would have to approach the ethics committee to get this permission for waiver of consent. Because most journals would ask you regarding these two distinct issues. One is the research ethics committee overview, and second is consent. So to counter this portion, when you are writing your manuscript, when you're submitting a manuscript, you need to get both these clearances. So you ask your ethics committee for a waiver of written informed consent, and most ethics committees would give you in these circumstances.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Durga. So Dr. Ronak has a question here. He asks us, why do we write scientific papers? For the modern world, a scientific communication is your Twitter post, your blog, your WhatsApp message, all rolled into one. So was that a question, Dr. Ronak? Can you please clarify, or was that a statement? Because you're saying, because there are journals. Yes, Dr. Ronak. So if that was a question, definitely there, social media is the new frontier for dissemination of information, and there's a lot on that, and we probably have a lecture at the end of the webinar series scheduled for this. But the emerging issue is misinformation on social media channels, and this is something we'll talk about in great detail. Maybe you need to wait for our next series of lectures for that. Thank you.
Latika, I just wanted to comment on what Ronika said. I think this is a very good question, actually. Many of us are asking, you know, for lay public, I mean, this is what is it about? And the activities we see on the Twitter and the Facebook, and also my personal reservations about the preprint servers. I mean, people have to be convinced that what is the additional value of publishing in journals, really. So I don't think, you know, these are easy questions to be answered. But definitely, you know, look forward to one of the editorials in my journal on this issue. Thank you.
So there is another question from Dr. Lamis. A few narrative review articles aim to just gather information or evidence together rather than having a clear question or hypothesis. And is this justifiable, and how do reviewers assess that? So this, I feel, depends on whether the review is solicited or not. So a lot of journals sometimes solicit reviews from experts in the area, and a lot would depend on the quality and the type of journal and the kind of articles they like to publish. But if it is unsolicited, then definitely this is something of concern. And even in general, there should be a sense of direction in the review article and a clear message arising out of it. And the reviewer is of their free will. If they do, their intent is ideally is to enhance a manuscript. So I would say if the reviewers do not like it, they should always feel free to offer their comments.
Yep, so two things in that, Lamis. I don't know if that's your name or it's just a depiction of your name, Lamis. Gone are the days when the reviews used to be non-systematic. So most of the time we are doing only systematic reviews. And you can do a systematic reviews only if you have a hypothesis and a research question to be answered. And most of the systematic reviews are at the top of the evidence pyramid nowadays. And because there is so much literature around, that unless you do a systematic search of that literature and present your answers, nothing else is justifiable. An unsystematic review without a hypothesis, without any clear research question, is as good as the waste in your waste paper basket. So just trash it.
The other question is, why do case reports have low weightage? So case reports.
So there is nothing like low weightage or high weightage. Case reports have their own significance in the pyramid of evidence. And although it's like we tell that this is high and this is low and this is best and this is not best, but case reports and other research styles and research methodologies have individual values and individual value depending upon the research question that you are trying to answer. A case report for something, let me give you an example. When COVID started, the first time we ever got the details of the patient on WhatsApp or on other media, we realized how valuable that information was for us. And first time when we read anosmia is a feature, that didn't come as a randomized control trial, that didn't come as a longitudinal study, that didn't come as a meta-analysis, that didn't come as a systematic review. It came as a case report, practically as a case report. So it's wrong to say that they have a low value or a high value. They have their own place and their own significance. Dr. Ravindran, I'm sure you want to add something on that.
Thank you, Dr. Goel. Yes, very, very relevant. I think case reports are extremely important. And for this, I mean, both the Indian Journal of Rheumatology and the Edinburgh Journal have case report sections. So, you know, images, cases of the quarter, case-based reviews, or individual case reports, even as letter to the editors, we have been publishing. And they, Dr. Goel has said, within the sort of, you know, the pyramid of structure of the knowledge or the knowledge structure, it has got its own value. If you look at the olden literature of medicine, they all have been written by keen observers. They did not know this will lead on to a discovery of new disease in 300 years time. So basically, if you read the old literature, they are all case reports. But the observations, if had they not been shared in this sort of, you know, scientific domain, we would not have probably discovered or might have discovered them, you know, much later. For the Royal College Journal, we have what is called College Journal Prize, where we, so it is for the trainees. The first author should be a trainee. So we have the original articles, but we have a prize for the case reports also. And I would have this sent across to everybody, a beautiful advocacy on the case reports by Stefan Slatter in the March issue of the journal, which says, if case reports be the food of knowledge, write on our cases of the quarter. Beautiful. Thank you.
Dr. Durga would like to add something to this.
Hello. Yeah, I just wanted to add a point about the question regarding narrative reviews. Actually, what happens as of today is one often gets a lot of systematic reviews which are generated by commercial companies from certain regions of the world, not India, fortunately. And very often they would just be redundant. A narrative review that is written by an expert in the field with a critical overview and with a focused objective is sometimes much more valuable than those systematic reviews, which may be redundant and may not really provide a critical overview, may just provide a synthesization of the literature without critically looking at what it really means. So again, for a narrative review also, for young authors, I would suggest you always have a systematic search strategy to guide your narrative review, to answer specific questions, and try to focus your review on that. That would be most valued by reviewers and editors in many journals.
All right, thank you so much everyone for joining us today. And we have a few more questions pouring in, but maybe we will begin the next session by taking them. I'll make a mental note of these questions and hope to see you again on next Tuesday. Thank you and good night.